It's up against the Don roadway. We can raise the Don roadway and create a burn, and we still have the river that goes out between the Polson and Cousin Key, and also still have a navigable waterway through the Keedy. That's the alternative that we've looked at most closely, but all three are being examined, and the data and the flood modeling and all the costing have been done for all three. So that's the first topic of conversation that should be presented with this evening. Let's talk about the market and what kind of development could go down there. Basically, our consultants took a look at what the market would be for the whole GTA and then said what, in their experience and examples, could happen in the Portlands in terms of market share for the whole GTA development. And basically, this is their results. 6,700 to 8,000 residential units in a compact form, i.e. multifamily dwellings, which fits the places to grow strategy for densification. That's going to take, depending upon how you package them up and how big the buildings are, how you spread them around, 40 to 80 acres. They also believe that there's a market for office development, but not AAA, Bay and King kind of buildings, but more the kind of buildings which are single A, smaller, shorter, or Class B or Class C, the kind of building, office buildings you would see in the 905. Because the market can't, this location cannot compete with the downtown area, and therefore would compete more with decisions that are made by people who go to the 905 rather than the city somewhere. The retail we're showing here is the retail that would be in demand to service those office and the residential there. So this is local retail, supportive retail to the development that's projected in the Portlands here. So you have 40 to 80 acres for residential, you have 40 to 90 acres, again, depending upon how you configure the office space. For retail, 5 to 10 acres, as I said, it's just local-based retail. The final item is industrial slash port, and there was a bit of debate between the consultants and the landowners in the area. The landowners are mostly focused on industrial uses, and their argument is, we are a very important part of the city building. You need concrete to build the city, you need salt to make the roads safe, you need sugar to support our huge food processing industry in this region, and if energy prices continue to go where they've been going, shipping or moving goods and commodities by ship will become more, not less important. So port use is important. So they argue that, in fact, there could be more port use in the future. The consultants are saying you're flatlining at best on industrial use in the city. And so we're trying to figure out the exact number. There won't be a lot of new industrial use. There may be a little bit, and we're still trying to determine that. But if you average that in, the maximum use by demand under current circumstances in the Portlands would be for 100 to 200 acres. Remember what I said at the beginning. There are 1,000 acres down there. Obviously, the full opportunity there, based upon current trends, is not going to be used up in 20 years. So what are the costs that are going to go against the kind of revenue that a development could generate? The reconfigured flood protection environmental assessment process would end up plus or minus $400 million, a lot less than the scenario that was looked at last summer. If you wanted to put all the pipes, rebuild all the roads, bring transit to the area, fix the dock walls, fix the soil problems, soil contamination problems, bury the high transmission wire, do a lot of different things in the Portlands to get the whole area up to typical Toronto standard in the rest of Toronto, would cost somewhere in the order of $2 to $2.5 billion for the entire 1,000 acres to get it all up to standard. So we get to a $2.5 to $3 billion tab. But we've already said we only need development for 100 to 200 acres above what is already there. So clearly, we don't have to solve that whole problem all at one time. when we look at that, we've got to figure out what the implications are in terms of how much revenue that development could generate through increased assessment potentially, through property sales, because the city owns 40% of the land, 400 acres, through the Toronto Portlands Company. And how can we deal with infrastructure on a phased or part development basis rather than trying to solve it all at one time? And how can we do that phasing in the most constructive manner? So that part of the conversation is your second, what we've just gone through, is your second topic for tonight. Your third topic is to talk about the planning implications of where you could go with 100 to 200 acres, since you're not going to go to the whole thing. So these circles represent what the 20 acres, sorry, what the 20-year development could be, and the fact it could fit in many different places in the Portlands. So one of our challenges is to try to figure out in an orderly fashion where best this development could go. This is sort of gross land usage. So the development plus the local part lines, plus the road allowances, plus the community uses are all wrapped up into those numbers. So we know that if we're not going to get all the funding. Nobody's going to write a $2.5 to $3 billion check, whether it's the public sector, the private sector, or a mix of those in the next foreseeable future. And we know that we don't need to solve all the problems for the whole Portlands, or the infrastructure challenges, right away. So we're going to take a look at it in basically chewable chunks, or the planners use the word precincts. So these are some of the different precincts that we're looking at, either north of the ship channel, or we call it the Keating precinct, south of the ship channel, which is the first south of the ship, south of the Keating channel. The first area is basically Cousins Key. And then further down, the two areas there they're based on Polson Key. And then east of the Don Roadway is sort of the south of Lakeshore, includes the film precinct and a number of other areas that are there. One of the advantages, and one of the big advantages of the 4WS realigned, is that the flood protection work can be done in a phased way, so that some of these areas can be freed up. So just by building the just by building the south into the ship channel spillway, actually the modeling so far shows that that would free up the land on the westmost edge of both Polson and Cousin Key, probably the most valuable land in the Portlands. If you build the berm underneath a raised Don roadway to keep the water on the west side of the Don, that frees up all the floodplain that is east of the Don roadway. So the film precinct, the south side of Lakeshore, in fact, south of Eastern, comes out of the floodplain, which is in right now. So one final slide, just to show you the magnitude of the challenge that's in front of visioning building out the Portlands. If you laid over the Portlands, over top of the existing city of Toronto, Leslie Street, which is the eastmost edge of the Portlands, sits on top of Parliament Avenue. If you go over to Cherry Street, which runs down pretty close to the westmost side, you're actually driving down Spadina. If you're driving across Unwin Avenue, which is at the south end, you're basically going along Front Street. And if you're driving along Lakeshore, you're going across Dundas. And it's taken us how long to build out? Took us how long to build out that part of Toronto and then continue to rebuild it? You can see the magnitude. This is by far the largest urban redevelopment area that I know of in the developed Western world. Am I right to say that, Joe? Yes. So both jokes. So it's a huge challenge, but with that challenge comes a phenomenal opportunity, as Councillor Fletcher mentioned. So I'm looking forward to your comments this evening about how we can maximize that opportunity in a way that meets and exceeds the community interests. Thank you very much.